Hey guys, Chicago. Hi. So, the reason I chose this topic I thought I would do for the smaller presentation, but I asked Dr. Rustam if I could do it for a larger presentation, is because a lot of my own family are suffering from nicotine addiction, and I thought that this is a good way for me to address not only you guys, but also them. That's why Eric is going to videotape it. Thank you so much. So, nicotine addiction, if I can show you, let me see.
They say nicotine isn't addictive. How can they say that?
So you see, nicotine...
That was an example of demon possession.
Actually...
we're talking about that last night.
Debbie Austin, and she died at 62, and she started smoking at the age of 30. She couldn't stop. Tobacco kills more Americans each year, and not just Americans, all over the world, more than alcohol, cocaine, crack, heroin, homicide, suicide, car accidents, fire, and AIDS put together.
Wow.
What is tobacco addiction? We have the DSM says that tobacco is... if you see, what is tobacco? It is basically, tobacco addiction is from tobacco smoke and have numerous constituents. And the worst thing is the nicotine. Nicotine is one of the few natural alkaloids that exist in liquid state. And it's really harmful. We're going to see it how. Symptoms, according to DSM, one of the symptoms that you see is unsuccessful attempts to quit. An inordinate amount of time acquiring tobacco, craving for tobacco and everything else. And I can send you the slide if you just email me. Or I will send it to you guys anyways. nicotine withdrawal symptoms. If you see, there are tons of withdrawal symptoms. That is the reason why people kind of like crave to go back and they just don't want to face irritability, depression, restlessness. So they would almost be like on fire. They just need to take another puff. They just need that so bad. If you look at the withdrawal symptoms, it says that on the onset of typical nicotine addiction, withdrawal symptoms are present, and there are different types of withdrawal symptoms, early remission, sustained remission, and different types. Now, question is, you know, WHO says, who says, despite all the horror facts, why do people still smoke? Tobacco contains nicotine, which is a highly addictive substance. Nicotine addiction creates both physical and psychological dependency. That is the problem. If it was only physical, it's one thing. If it was psychological, it's a different thing. So, because it's a combination of both, it becomes extremely addictive. Nicotine is among the most addictive drugs. You can see the chart that shows it's more addictive than alcohol, cocaine, heroin, and everything else. So, pharmacokinetics. Pharmacokinetics means the effect the drug has on the body. So what kind of effect does it have? It absorbs the drug, it distributes, it metabolizes, it excretes. In pharmacodynamics, we know that what effect does a the effect of the drug on the body. So what does the drug to us do to us? In an acidic media, the drug is poorly absorbed. That's why American cigarettes are a little more acidic than cigarettes in many other places. In alkaline media, it is extremely well absorbed. And if you see this part, where the absorption is pH dependent. So you have to know if, what is a person's body constituency. Some people have acidic problem, they will have less absorption. But otherwise, it's really fast. The ABCs of nicotine addiction. If we consider the A, the addict and the addiction, it causes arousal, it causes addictive personality. If there's addictive personality features, it kind of like increases it. Then absence of good coping mechanisms. Some people use it as like, you know, okay, I don't know what to do, I need to smoke, kind of thing. Then belief. They have a faulty belief system. That is why they do it. Believe that addiction is an emotional relationship with an object. They kind of believe that they, like, if they stop, as if they're gonna like do something bad. It's like they owe nicotine something. They owe something to their smoke or whatever. Then they have a cycle of addiction. So there is a cycle begins with negative emotion that they want something that is worked before, so they use nicotine, and then it kind of becomes a ritual. Then again, there is a withdrawal, they feel bad, they go back to nicotine. So as Dr. Rustam was teaching us, you know, it's both. So our mind has that faulty belief system. So as therapists, it is our responsibility to teach people who are addicts to understand that this is just a part of their brain that they have learned, it can be unlearned. And D is decline process, loss of control. An addicted brain is a changed brain. There is a loss of control. Tolerance increases, begins to experience impairment. And also we see in E, if you see, enabling a vicious cycle. Sometimes they kind of get upset with their family, so the family say, go and smoke. Probably that'll make you feel a little better, you know? And then F, family connections. Maybe their fathers used to smoke. The son gets into it. So it comes down in the family. So if you guys are parents, and if you're smoking, or if you know some who are parents, you can tell them that, hey guys, you're not only destroying you, but you're destroying your family. How prevalent is this? It's all over the world. And this is nicotine in India. In India, it's used in different forms. Like, I was talking to Dr. Rustam, like, you know, in India, they use chew tobacco a lot, and other forms. And I have given a list of that, including chew tobacco, pan, gutka, pan things, and tobacco containing in toothpaste. My maternal grandmother uses a toothpaste which has tobacco in it. So imagine the effect it has. So tobacco, either when we are smoking, in almost 7 to 12 seconds, it reaches your brain. When you are otherwise through your saliva, your body is absorbing it. So it's very addictive, and I don't know if she still is got over it or not. So these are some of the pictures. If you see, kids sell these tobaccos, and they eat it too. You know, it's available in small packets, in sachets, and it's so sad. An addicted brain is a changed brain. If you see these pictures, you will see how differently an addicted brain works. You know, from people who have died, when they have done their tests on them, from them to even people who are living when they're smoking, they have done tests and they have seen their brain just acts differently. So it's causing a whole change. Nicotine addiction in the lungs, you know, you've seen ads where, you know, because the smoke is going straight into the lungs with the tar particle, the tar gets in the lungs. And that tar kind of like makes a coating on the lungs. And then also when you metabolize it, it goes to the kidney. So the kidney has the rest of the things which have to be metabolized, and it completely wrecks it. One of my own loved ones had like a cancer in, I think, in one of the kidneys and had to get it operated. And guess how that feels on their family, on themselves. They are wrecking, it's just a wreck. Nicotine has a half-life of 2 hours. It's converted to cotinine, which has a half-life of 19 hours. So the effect stays basically for 2 hours. So like, because when they sleep the whole night, they are not getting any nicotine. When they wake up, they need that first smoke. They just become crazy otherwise. I have seen that, trust me. Oh my gosh. It's metabolized and excreted through kidney and through urine and all kinds of stuff. So how does it play out if you see the chemistry of it? So in central nervous system, it gives pleasure, it gives arousal, it improves, they say that it helps them improve task. It gives anxiety, their relief to their anxiety. But in that, they become stuck in that chain again. Because they think that that is the only way. But we know that that is not the only way of getting relief from all these kind of things. It suppresses their appetite. Therefore, addicts have lesser weight. It's been generally observed. And also, it causes cardiovascular problem. One of my maternal uncle, he passed away when he was like in 50s from heart attack because he was into smoking so much. You know? What did it do? Because nicotine has a chemical effect, it impacts your dopamine, it impacts your all these kind of things that you're seeing. Therefore, they want pleasure, it gives them reward, it has mood regulation and all kind of it helps them relieve their anxiety. That's why they want it so bad. And this is the chain that they keep going. So if you're a male, this is how it's going to affect you. It's going to affect your blood, lungs, gastrointestine. It gives you joint pain. It wrecks your central nervous system, heart, endocrine system. If you're a woman, it also has a problem. Like you were talking how, as women, we are different. And it affects the unborn babies or the babies that are in our stomach. So we have to change. Secondhand smoking. It was, like you guys know, even in India, it's still people smoke. Here, there are still like smoking zones, but not so much in India.
The rest of the world.
And so it's classified as a known cause for lung cancer, in irritants to the eyes, throat, estimates 3,000 death a year. Like, you want to die and you want to make sure that other people around you die as well. And then secondhand smoke causes lung cancer. This guy did a lot of research and helped to establish that secondhand smoking is bad. His name is Surgeon General Richard Carmona, and he said that I'm grateful to be here today. And that he said that secondhand smoke is not a mere annoyance, but a serious health hazard that causes premature death, disease in children and non-smoking adults. How does it cause problems? It causes lung cancers, it causes heart diseases, it interferes with your normal functioning of your heart, lungs, it gives asthma. So the question therefore is, people need to stop quitting. If you stop quitting before the age of 30, you gain 10 years of life. My uncle who died at 50, if he had lived 10 more years, he could have seen his daughter's marriage, grandchild being born. What about that? I mean, we think about, okay, now I can't function, so I need the smoke right now. But what about the future that we are compromising? The ones that is more precious, you know? Tobacco dependence and recovery. So we have to deal it in two levels, psychological and behavioral. Physiological and behavioral, because those are the two realms that are being affected. So these are some of the instruments that we can use. I'm not going to go through them, but you can see it. It's there are ways that we can assess it through this readiness ruler and also assessment components that we need to help them go through. These are things that we need to give them. Like the 5 A's of TEACH method, which is developed in Canada, is ask about tobacco use, advice to quit, assess willingness to make a quit attempt, assist in quit attempt, arrange follow-up. And we give them this daily diary baseline to help them monitor it. So what is the thing we need to do? First, they have to go through contemplation, preparation, action, and then finally maintenance. We have to take them through this process. 4 steps of stopping destructive behavior. Strategize, take action, optimize, and prevent relapse. We need to help them to go through this. These are, and since I'll be sending it out to you, when you have an addict who comes to you, who is suffering, who is struggling with this and wants to quit, these are important things that you need to help them go through. You need to help them make a decision. This is very important, decision to change worksheet. They need to write it down. They need to come to that decision that we need to change, and a goal statement, why they are doing that, what is the goal now, and all that kind of stuff. So these are the main stages. In pre-contemplation, it increases their salience, like, so pre-contemplation, so, and decision. In that, you have to make them weigh their pros and cons. Why should I give up smoking? What are the benefits? What are the disadvantages? And it's always that the benefits always, you know, overweigh the disadvantage. And action, maintenance, and the last part is important. Imagine if you talk about relapse, talking about relapse is so important because sometimes people think, oh, I tried it once, I can't do it again. I am just a failure. But when we are doing therapy, we need to talk about what happens if you have a relapse. They have to come back. So these are the medications for helping people quit. Most of them you know, nicotine gums, lozenges, patch, inhaler, and then other pills. These are some of the pictures of it. So the attitude. What is the attitude both for us and our clients? Don't give up hope. Hope is the main thing. Hope is, we need to help people to understand that it change is possible. That has to be in their brains. And it has to be in our brains. We should not give up that hope. We have Narcotic Anonymous who would support them. In Narcotic Anonymous, I want to talk about the first 2 steps. Admit that they are powerless. And we saw it in Alcoholic Anonymous. So what do we admit? That we have failed. And we know that, you know, it's not just people who smoke. All of us have failed in some way or the other. And we come to a power that's greater than us. And that power is Jesus Christ. All that God says, okay, I will help you, bless you, do this. But Jesus said, I will set you free from sin. He says, I have come for the sinners. So if you come to Jesus, if our clients come to Jesus, they will be set free from this addiction. And we know we can help them to go through to celebrate recovery. We should know that, okay, that God loves us. And He's there to take care of us. Even though we don't know what problems we have, how to solve this problem at this point, but we have a God who can. And if we trust that, He will definitely, and when we believe that, you know what, I have failed so much, but Jesus Christ, who is God, loved me and died for me on the cross. And He rose again and broke the power of sin. And therefore He can give me victory. If you, our clients believe that, if you and I believe that, then definitely He will be saved. So 1, 2, 3 of hopes. There is no pit so deep that God's love is not deeper. God's love is not deeper still. Like, I mean, no matter where you are, God is able to pull you out. Jesus came full of grace and truth. We need to know about that grace. We need to face pain. Okay, there is pain. But we need to face it. We just don't need to give up to that pain and go back to that addiction, to go back to that sin. The truth has to be told. We, as therapists, we need to tell the truth. That's why I'm making this video, so that my family can hear the truth. And, you know, the truth has to be told. And responsibility. Okay, I have failed it before. I have, all my life I have done it this. Doesn't mean that I can't change. So past failures doesn't prevent future success. Change is not something you, as clients, we do to people, but we do with people. And for my family, stay strong because you're worth it. So we need to take courage.